For decades, libertarians have had a phrase, the cult of the omnipotent state. Many of us have been exposing the behavior of these cultists as they use the same tactics as creationists when their bogosity is challenged. Their defense of this usually goes something like this.
Wah! Mommy! The Birdman called me a creationist!
No, we didn't. We pointed out that they use the same tactics as creationists, because that is exactly what they do. In this video, I want to examine the idea that statism is a cult, and that the people who mindlessly defend it are very much cultists, by looking at the five different things that cults do in order to indoctrinate their members and set them against outsiders. We'll look at them one by one, and unless you're already a fully indoctrinated cult member, I think you'll find the government, together with the news media, are guilty of these very same brainwashing practices. There are five steps in cult indoctrination. The first step is that people are convinced they have problems they cannot solve. Just think of how many problems we're faced with. Unemployment, terrorism, global warming, crime, healthcare that's too expensive, oil and energy crises, inflation, on and on and on. One tactic of the cult is to take problems people face and make them believe they cannot solve them on their own. We can't solve the drug problem on our own. We can't create jobs on our own. We can't afford healthcare on our own. And so on. In fact, really think about it. Are there any real problems in your life that you can solve on your own, according to the government? It's hard to think of any, is it? But it's not because there are no such problems, it's because you've already solved them. So government likes to fill your head day in and day out with problems that you can't solve, or at least problems it claims you can't solve. And then it jumps right into step two. Problems are reduced to one simple explanation repeatedly emphasized. The cult and government both make sure to give a simplistic explanation for these problems, usually placing the blame somewhere other than the government. You can't get a job because of greedy capitalists. Our expensive healthcare is a failure of the free market. We're under a threat of terrorism because Muslims hate us for our freedom and want to kill us. When I was growing up, they said the same thing about communists. Crime happens because of those horrible drugs that we need police to get off our streets. Every problem has a simplistic explanation and a nice boogeyman to point to. Of course, most of our problems are much more complex than that, and many, perhaps even most of them, are caused by the very government who tries to ride in on a white steed and save us. Unemployment, for the most part, has to do with government's fiscal and monetary and regulatory policies, not greedy capitalists. Wouldn't greedy capitalists want to hire you so that you can help them make products for people to buy, thereby making a bigger profit? Healthcare, as I've shown in other videos, was made expensive by government interference and in no way resembles a free market. Same with the banking industry. It wasn't lack of regulations that caused the financial crisis because they were laden down with hundreds, if not thousands, of new regulations every month. Just a tiny amount of research, or even just a few moments of considered thought, is enough to completely dismantle many of these claims. If crime happens because of drugs, then why not because of alcohol or tobacco? And why did it happen with alcohol in the 1920s? Because the crime is a result of government prohibition, not the drugs themselves. Terrorism, as I've explained before, operates in a complex web of cause and effect, tied in with our interventionist foreign policy, which creates hatred and a desire for vengeance. In fact, both with cults and with government, it's so easy to expose these problems, they have to rely on the next method of cult indoctrination, entrapment. This is where information is controlled to the point that the cult's version of events is reinforced, and any opposing voices, if allowed at all, are kept at bay by being belittled and marginalized, drowned out by the version given repeatedly to the masses. I think we all know this happens with government and the all-too-complicit news media. Any view that isn't mainstream, in other words, isn't what they themselves espouse, is fringe or even kooky. Those who state such viewpoints are belittled, and everything is put into place to poison the well against them and their ideas. If you want a constitutional government with a federalist structure, you're a neo-Confederate. If you want free markets, you're a shill for the rich. If you want a sane monetary policy, you're marginal. and that's really nothing more than an appeal to popularity. If you want drugs to be legalized, then obviously you're a junkie who wants kids to buy crack in vending machines. If you want to have our civil liberties respected at airports and everywhere else, or if you want a sane and rational foreign policy, you're an anti-American who wants the terrorists to win. If you want to ease regulation so small businesses can flourish, then obviously you hate the poor and want the rich to have everything. There is not a single bit of it that actually comprises an intellectual, factual, rational response to the argument. Strawman arguments and character assassination are employed regularly to convince people that only a truly horrible person would even consider those alternative viewpoints. It's very effective. In fact, the only problem with it is that all this negativity leaves a vacuum that needs to be filled, which is where the next tool of cult indoctrination comes in. A charismatic, courageous leader pretends to care about them. Whether it's Barack Obama or George W. Bush or, well, pretty much every president ever, he has come into power not because people are intellectually convinced that his proposals are sound, but because he won the popularity contest by getting people to like him. More than that, they convince people that they truly care. Barack Obama cares so much about minorities or the inequality of women or of homosexuals. Recently, he's reversed his long-standing opposition to gay marriage to say that, yes, gays should be allowed to marry. He doesn't do anything about it, of course, doesn't even propose anything. And yet, his followers go all gaga, saying how brave and courageous he is to finally, after almost 4 years, tell people what they want to hear. Because he cares, you know? Of course, they thought he cared all along when he was against gay marriage, but that doesn't stop them. Many unthinking people are even claiming that this was his real position all along. He was just in such a difficult position he couldn't actually say so. So where was his courage then? And what about all the people who were speaking out in favor of it, some of whom have been doing it for decades? Likewise, George W. Bush was seen as a man of courage. He was courageous going into Iraq, even though that's what he had been looking for an excuse to do ever since he entered office. The evidence showed that the claim of Iraq having ties to terrorism and having weapons of mass destruction were nothing but a pack of lies, and this evidence existed even before Bush engaged in hostilities against Iraq. Still, it got no play in the news media, even as the Iraq war raged on. Video of Bush ducking a shoe that was thrown at him got much better coverage. Politicians always play themselves up as people capable of solving our problems. Problems that, according to them, we ourselves are entirely helpless to solve. We can't do it individually, and we just aren't able to form groups to do it either. Yet government, which is nothing more than a group of people, is able to solve all sorts of problems, from economic problems like poverty and unemployment, to how to raise our kids, to how we should travel around the country. Think about it. Apple can't even properly decide how many new iPhones to send to different stores. They always end up selling out in some places with a surplus in others. They are leaders in this market, and this is their own product. Yet they're unable to get good information about this one very basic aspect of doing business. Yet government claims to know how to build the roads, how to run banks, how to make us safe at airports, on and on and on. The information that the leaders in their own industry can't even get is somehow accessible to politicians in every industry in existence. Again, government is nothing more than a group of people. But to say that one group of people is capable of doing things that no other group could possibly do, not even experts working in their own field, is to say that this group has supernatural abilities, and they become saints. Demigods, as infallible as Catholics consider the Pope to be, even as they prove themselves year after year to be incompetent failures. But those failures, of course, are always someone else's fault, and if we just give them more power and more of our tax money and give up just a little more of our precious liberties, they'll swoop in and solve the problem in no time. The definition of omniscient is having total knowledge, which is what government must have to do all of this. The definition of omnipotent is all-powerful, which government needs to be able to achieve all of this. And in order to care about us to the extent of wanting to help every single American, they have to be beneficent. Beneficent, omnipotent, and omniscient. Remind you of anyone? Number 5, identity is based on the group. This is probably the best tool both the cult and the government have of getting us to go along with them. I've referred to this as America's political false dichotomy. People are shoehorned into one of two groups: liberal, left, or Democrat, and right, conservative, or Republican. Almost the entirety of our political debate in this country is pitting people in these groups against each other, even if there is no real difference at all between them. George W. Bush waged war, expanded the deficit, increased domestic spending such as education, expanded healthcare coverage, restricted our civil liberties, and grew the size of government. Barack Obama waged war, expanded the deficit, increased domestic spending such as education, expanded healthcare coverage, restricted our civil liberties, and grew the size of government. And yet, to people entrenched in the cult, those two presidents are as different as night and day. When George W. Bush violated the Constitution to wage war, Democrats said it was a war for oil and we had no business being there. Oh, but they still voted for it. When Barack Obama violated the Constitution to wage war in Libya, Republicans said it was reckless and irresponsible, probably because it wasn't their war. According to Democrats, George W. Bush ruined healthcare by denying government coverage, even though he didn't do one thing to reduce government coverage and even expanded it by giving pharmaceutical benefits to Medicare and Medicaid patients. According to Republicans, Obamacare is a disaster, incredibly expensive, and a hideous assault on our liberties, even though everything it did was supported and advocated by the Republicans in the 1990s. When George W. Bush signed the Patriot Act and formed the Department of Homeland Security and the TSA, Democrats bemoaned the loss to our civil liberties, even as they themselves voted for it. Then, with not only a Democratic president, but Democratic majorities in the House and Senate, these were expanded to be able to do more warrantless wiretapping and even grope our junk at airports. The U.S. government has even given itself the power to detain U.S. citizens indefinitely, which was passed by a Republican House and a Democratic Senate and signed by Barack Obama, who had previously promised to veto it. George W. Bush's economic stimulus program was panned by President Obama, even though Senator Obama voted for them. But all Obama had to do was change the name from bailout to stimulus, and suddenly taking wealth from the poor, the middle class, and small businesses and giving it to big corporations and banks was just the right thing to do. Of course, neither one did a damn thing to help the economy, but guess what? They still worked. How? He stopped it from getting any worse. If only we had spent more, we'd be out of this crisis. Yeah, and sure, the patient failed to get better, but that's because we didn't use enough leeches. Get the idea? Both sides do exactly the same thing, they just put their own spin on it and complain when the other side does the same thing. Our wars are good, their wars are bad. When we take your money to give to banks and corporations, it's good, but when they do it, it's bad. When we infringe on your civil liberties, it's necessary and we have a damn good reason. When they do it, it's because they're evil. Of course, a lot of you are probably screaming at this video about the real differences between Democrats and Republicans. Things like gay marriage, or creationism, or religious freedom. If that's the case, you really need to ask yourself two questions. 1. Are we any better or worse off with these subjects than we were, say, 20 years ago? And the answer is, not really. Some states have banned gay marriage, others allow it. Creationism wasn't allowed in schools then, and it still isn't now, although millions of taxpayer dollars have been spent going to court to stop it. 2. How do those issues compare to the destruction of our basic liberties and the ruination of our economy? If you honestly think these issues are more important, then I'm sorry to say it, but you are firmly entrenched in the cult of the omnipotent state. Mostly the only time either side brings them up is during an election year so they can pander and bristle up their fur at each other and hope they distract us enough to see that we still don't have any significant job growth. Those 5 things are universally recognized as the way cults indoctrinate people to gain their loyalty when they'd never be able to defend their bogosity rationally. As I've shown very clearly, government and the people who defend it do exactly these 5 things, to no less a degree than any given cult. When we say the cult of the omnipotent state, this is exactly what we're talking about. Government takes the place of God as a beneficent, omniscient, and omnipresent entity, with politicians and bureaucrats as demigods and saints who know more about how you should live your life than you do. There's even a devil of sorts, not an evil entity, but certainly a separate entity that needs to be dealt with, the economy. To the right, the economy is a Star Trek energy being, ready to solve all our problems if we just stop poking at it and say the right incantation. To the left, the economy is this big machine with levers and knobs that they can manipulate, and if they can just hit the right settings, all will be well. The truth is, the economy is you and me, and all other 300 million people in America, in the decisions we make and the interactions we engage in throughout the day, every day. To manipulate it, or adjust it, or steer it, is to interfere in voluntary interactions between free and peaceful people. Every single economic intrusion by government is not only an abrogation of our liberty, it makes us poorer as well. Every single one. They also have their lesser demons, ready to blame for our problems and ready to lead us in the fight against. Terrorists, immigrants, gays, Muslims, the religious right. Of course, if they would just follow the Constitution and leave us the hell alone, none of these would be a problem. We'd welcome immigrants to expand our workforce and make us even wealthier. There would be no terrorists without our military butting into other people's affairs. Gays and Muslims, and even the religious right, would just be people living out their lives without any power to affect how anyone else lives out their life. No one was ever made richer by joining a cult. In fact, they're made poorer, as the cult leaders get more and more money. The cult leaders tell them who they can do business with, who they can have sex with, and who the enemy is. Are you really telling me you don't see how government does these exact same things? And like the cult, we're all made poorer by this government action. The truth is, without government meddling, we wouldn't even have most of these problems, and the ones we did, we could solve on our own. The only drug problem we have that isn't a result of the war on drugs is addiction, but we can absolutely manage that on our own. Nicotine is the most addictive drug we know of, a statistical tie with heroin, and yet 50% of addicts quit within 10 years. We can do a lot better by letting these people help themselves than by throwing them in jail or even mandating a treatment program. The only education problem we would have without government meddling is, what's the best way to educate children in a 21st century society? And we can do that a lot better with schools competing against each other, innovating and developing new teaching techniques, instead of mandating an outdated 19th century model on today's kids, boring them out of their natural desire to learn. And imagine what we could do on our own with trillions of dollars a year back in our pockets. That would be more than enough to buy a job for everyone who can work and charity for everyone who cannot. People in this country are good, kind, caring, and generous. We can and will take care of each other, as long as government stops robbing us of the means to do so. But the cult is dehumanizing. They want you to believe that people are selfish, evil, and malevolent. So of course we need to take some of these selfish, evil, and malevolent people and give them power over our lives. This makes sense. How? The cult of the omnipotent state has caused far too much harm, and we just can't afford it anymore. It's time to deprogram ourselves and each other, and to stop being drawn in every time we hear its siren song. It's time we all became apostates and called as much attention as possible to the cult and its ramifications. If enough of us start doing this, maybe the next generation will grow up to be the freest, most prosperous one ever.